So I'd like to welcome all of you here on behalf of the South Asia Institute and the Alwaleed Islamic Studies Program. This is a collaborative event that the two programs have put together. And this is the first in the series entitled Muslim Societies in South Asia. And we have three others this semester, and then in the spring semester we'll continue with the series. And the reason really for focusing on South Asia and Islam is that contrary to general sort of misperceptions, Islam is not primarily a Middle Eastern religion. It is primarily a South Asian religion in terms of numbers of people who live in South Asia. There are more Muslims who live in South Asia than the Middle East, easily. So because of that, to address this very important need in times when, you know, questions about Islam and so on are very much into the air, we need to remind people that this fusion of Islam and the Middle East is in fact quite deceptive, and that we should also be paying attention to Islam in other regions, particularly South Asia. So with that, I am really delighted and honored to introduce Professor Munis Faruqui, who is an associate professor in the Department of South and Southeast Asian Studies at University of California, Berkeley. He focuses on the Muslim experience in South Asia, especially during the Mughal period. His books include Princes of the Mughal Empire, published by Cambridge University Press, Expanding Frontiers in South Asian and World History, co-edited with Richard Eaton, David Gilmartin, and Sunil Kumar. These are three other very important scholars in the history of Islam in South Asia. And a third book, an edited volume, Religious Interactions in Mughal India, co-edited with Vasudha Dalmia. His various journal articles have interrogated the relationship between religion and politics in the life and work of Mughal Prince Dara Shikoh, who lived in 1615 to 1659, one of the most, I think, fascinating figures in the intellectual history of Mughal India, and the creation of the Mughal Empire under Emperor Akbar, again a figure who is much valorized in contemporary India as sort of the predecessor to a secular India. He's currently working on a book about the Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb. Again, a controversial figure in today's historiography. For some people, he's a hero. For some people, he's a villain. So you can see Professor Faruqui is very courageous to get into, to deal with figures who are controversial. In addition to his outstanding scholarship, he is a fabulous teacher. And in recognition of this, he received UC Berkeley's most prestigious honor for teaching, the Distinguished Teaching Award. The award recognizes teaching that, quote, incites intellectual curiosity in students, engages them thoroughly in the enterprise of learning, and has a lifelong impact, unquote. So with those words, I want to introduce Professor Faruqui, please, scholar and wonderful teacher. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Asani, and thank you to you, to Nora McGinn, Terry McGuane, the South Asia Institute, and of course the Prince Alwaleed Islamic Studies Program for inviting me here today. Today is an especially important day for me in some ways, because I had an invitation from Professor Asani to come out in March of this year, and I was forced to cancel it at the very last second. And besides feeling extremely guilty of doing so, I also was filled with extreme regret, because I assumed that I would never be invited back again, given the fact that the publicity had gone out and so much work had already happened to get me here. So On a very personal note, I'm very grateful to you, the Institute, and also the Alwaleed Islamic Studies Program. I assume you all know who the Mughals are, but just in case, here is my 30-second synopsis. They are Turks, ethnically speaking, from Central Asia, who over the course of six generations of rulers between the 16th and 17th centuries gradually extended their rule over much of the Indian subcontinent. At its height in the late 1600s, the Mughal Empire was the largest political entity that South Asian history had ever seen, larger than the British Empire in South Asia, certainly bigger than contemporary India, and probably bigger than some of the other preceding empires like the Guptas and the Mauryas. This leads me, of course, to the central question of today's talk, which has to do with, you know, I guess a certain degree of wonderment on my part as to how an ethnic Turkish group who happened to also be Muslim and Persian speaking, who comprised no more than probably 0.1% of South Asia's population in the 16th and 17th centuries, came to construct such an extensive and expansive empire. Needless to say, historians have been thinking about this question for a very, very long time. It's probably one of the oldest questions around. The lineage of modern day, or at least I would say what we would call modern historical thinking, can be traced back to people like Elphinstone and Alexander Dow and people in the 1700s who began to ponder Mughal success as a way of thinking through the place of the British in South Asia. Broadly, there are four clusters of responses to Mughal success, and I'll just offer them to you. There might be others, but these are the four that come to mind more centrally. The first has to do with just the individual genius of Mughal emperors. So, answering the question, how are the Mughals so successful? Well, it's because Akbar was just such a fine man, you know, or Jahangir or Shah Jahan. So it tends to base itself on the psychology of emperors and the skills of particular individuals. This tends to be a slightly older rendition of the question of why the Mughals were so successful, and the British were usually tended to focus on this kind of individualistic aspect. The second cluster of responses to the question mostly focus on the administrative mechanisms that the Mughals put together, specifically looking at the bureaucratic structures of power that the Mughals construct from Akbar's reign onwards. This is, of course, a school of a line of thinking that was very popular among historians who were connected with the Aligarh school of historiography, Indian historiography. For those of you who don't know, the Aligarh school is named after Aligarh Muslim University, and the majority of historians in this school were Marxists, not particularly interested in questions of religion, of religious identity, or in fact in exploring potential other alternative avenues or explanations. They were particularly keen on trying to understand the Mughals as a kind of pre-modern or early modern analog to the British. So if the British were this kind of complicated bureaucratic state, the Mughals were their precursors in the South Asian context. And in a sense, this is a school of thought that was really dominant from the 1950s onwards to about the early 1990s. But then there are two more additional lines of thinking about Mughal success. The third one has its roots largely in militaristic explanations. So looking at the use of gunpowder, particular kinds of technologies, the harnessing of certain kinds of military technologies against Indian opponents, but also more recently thinking about things and phenomena like the horse trade and control over horses and the supply of horses between South Asia and Central Asia. The fourth and final kind of line of thinking is mostly focused on the economics of empire. And here, specifically, historians are interested in understanding how money, large amounts of money, basically mined in South and Central America, make their way makes its way across the Pacific Ocean to China, but then also onwards to Mughal India. And for many historians, the answer of Mughal success lies in good fortune. The conquistadors managed to get to the Americas. They tapped into the wealth of the Americas. This money flowed onwards to China and the Mughals, and voila. And hence, the Mughals are a successful case of empire building, but the Suris are not, who were a kind of precursor dynasty to the Mughals, because the Suris were a generation too early. Okay? So here you have a certain degree of explanations as to why this empire is able to embed itself in the South Asian context. Now, without discounting any of these explanations, my work tries to suggest perhaps an alternative route, another way of thinking about the question of rise and eventually decline. I know that's a loaded term. Let's call it decentralization. And so the starting point of my talk today lies in Mughal allegiance to a very interesting phenomenon. This is the phenomenon of open-ended succession. In other words, the Mughals never move towards a system of primogeniture. They never move to a system of ordered succession. Now, this is contrary to what happens after the early 1600s with both the Ottomans and the Safavids, you know, who are also Islamic dynasties like the Mughals. After the early 1600s, both of these groups to the west move towards ordered systems of succession, which in the Ottomans' case results ultimately in primogeniture. The Mughals never go in this direction. Instead, they keep an open-ended system of succession where any son, whether he is born of a legally wedded mother or a concubine, has an equal right to the Mughal throne. And so, in a sense, what you have with the Mughal Empire from the 1500s right through to the early 1700s is a system in which princes effectively view one another as competitors. And the only way in which they're going to ever attain the Mughal throne is by fighting one another. I essentially argue, and without giving too much away in a nutshell, I basically say that it's this competitive energy that is coursing through the Mughal system because of these particular kinds of compulsions linked to effectively life and death of particular princes that has a really significant impact in the kinds of ways by which the Mughals will embed themselves in the political imagination of South Asians, not only their own subjects, but others as well. Now, what is interesting about this is that, and just a kind of footnote to this thought, is that, again, historians have often decried the lack of an ordered system of succession. And I'm not just talking about colonial historians who were fixated on the idea of primogeniture and creating systems of succession that were ordered in India and resembled systems of succession in Britain. I'm also talking about contemporary historians who see in this kind of open-ended system of succession, a kind of potential free-for-all between sons of the emperor, they see chaos. They see, obviously, violence. They see the possibility for the destruction of the Mughal Empire. And it is a very enduring idea that has a lineage from the 1700s almost up to the contemporary present. And in a sense, my work is hopefully going to revise some of these ideas about how violence, in fact, does not sap the Mughals and perhaps other imperial units as well, but in fact adds in a kind of cumulative sense to the strength of the empire. And that's basically what I'm going to try to do for the rest of today's talk. So to understand this process and how it effectively unfolds over the course of someone's life, let's begin with the moment of birth. Okay. Princes are not born to random mothers. Okay. Women were often very carefully chosen for very particular kinds of ties to perhaps ethnic groups, perhaps to regions, to perhaps powerful political supporters, or perhaps as a way of drawing people into the ambit of the dynasty. So these boys were often, you know, the progeny or the offspring of very careful decisions. Furthermore, what is really interesting about successive generations of Mughal princes is that they tend to vary in number between two, Humayun has two sons, and I hope you've all received a handout. It's just making its way around. So Humayun has two sons, which is on the low end, but then you have someone like Aurangzeb, who has five sons. But you tend not to have more than that number, which I think speaks to a very controlled system of reproduction within the Mughal harem, and I'd be happy to talk about this maybe in the question and answer session. But the point is that you have a small number of princes who will be born over the course of a certain period. These boys, from the day that they are born, their lives are politically charged and invested. Okay? So it's not just the moment of them being produced by two people, but also the moment they are born, they are given access to people who the emperor considers important to their upbringing. In other words, you know, to make them perhaps men of the sword and men of the pen, well-rounded individuals, so their education is important, but also to afford them access to very important power nodes within South Asia's diverse society. So decisions about who their foster mothers would be, questions about whether the foster mother has got sons, how many sons, these are questions that will be often thought through by the emperor, maybe in consultation with others, but the emperor usually is the person who will make any sort of final judgment about this. But other decisions are equally significant. Who is the boy's guardian going to be? How often do you want to change the guardian, or ataliq, as the word is often described in the sources? These are very important questions, and these are questions that get to the very heart of a prince's possible future success. Because without the right decisions being made, in a sense, without a prince being afforded from very early on protection, but also access to the power nodes of Indian society, you're effectively dooming this boy. And that was not the purpose of an open-ended system of succession. The purpose of the system seems to have been to actually engender powerful boys who can do interesting things as young men and beyond. From Akbar's reign onwards, and again, Akbar reigns from 1556 to 1605, this small group of boys will be the primary political players within the Mughal Empire. Now, in previous generations, you had powerful noblemen who thought of themselves as on par, perhaps, with a prince. But after Akbar's reign, the gap, in a sense, the power gap between a prince and a powerful nobleman gets to be extremely large. And there is no question, especially after Akbar's reign, of a nobleman ever trying to ascend the Mughal throne to the exclusion of one of these princes. And so what you have starting in the 1500s is a real focus on the person of these young boys. And in a sense, the purpose of the system is such that noblemen have to make choices between these various boys, knowing that these boys will probably end up fighting one another at some point, maybe in 20 years, maybe in 30 years. So the key point over here, I think, in some ways, is that princes, no one else, become the focus of all the political energy within the Mughal system. As a result, and this is shown in various ceremonies that mark a young boy's life, his birth, often heralded, there are images in the Akbarnama of Salim's birth, but also other princes, his circumcision, perhaps at the age of 4 or 5, the beginning of his early education, the first time he starts to read the Quran. These are all moments that are marked within the imperial calendar. And a lot of attention is focused on these moments with the purpose not of just celebrating the boy, but of drawing your attention as participants within the Mughal system to the fact that there are only a certain number of players who you ultimately have to, in a sense, doff your cap to. So the boy's early education, the circumcision rituals, these are all markers of, in a sense, an emerging political and imperial persona. Very important. But the most important moment, perhaps, in a young man's life will come when he is anywhere between 13 and 18 years old. And this is when he is given adult status. Usually happens after puberty. Puberty often happened a little later for folks back in that period. So these boys get adult status slightly later than you would imagine. And sometimes they're 14 years old and you're like, what? But would someone get adult status at 14? It's because they have just hit puberty. Okay. So they receive adult status, and with adult status comes extraordinary wealth. Now, to give you a sense of how this works, a young prince, from the time that he's born, is given a daily stipend, an allowance of sorts. And this allowance is never a particularly big amount. For the times it was, but in the context of the Mughal Empire, it wasn't a particularly large amount. It could range from 20 rupees a day to maybe 100, 150 rupees a day once the boy is, 10, 11, 12 years old. But nothing big, nothing major, nothing to really write home about. But the moment they reach adult status, these boys will start to have access to salaries that will run in the millions of rupees. Okay? And as they get older, the money keeps increasing to the point where a prince like Khurram, who is the favorite son of Emperor Jahangir, Khurram, who becomes Shah Jahan, by the time he is in his late 20s, early 30s, has a salary of about 18 million rupees, which is a massive amount of money. Okay? And you have these princes basically gaining access to ever-increasing amounts of money, especially if they're favorites of their father. So adult status comes with a lot of money, but adult status comes with other things as well. For example, what do you do with this money? The most important thing that starts to emerge with adult status is the construction of princely retinues. Okay? Now, princes had households before adult status, but these households are small, they're circumscribed, and most of the personnel in these households are appointed by the emperor. With adult status, the power of the emperor to control a prince's retinue or household begins to recede. And the older the prince gets, the less control a father has over appointments within this household. Because, of course, now the prince has got access to money. He's independently wealthy, in a sense. So the authority of an emperor begins to recede as these boys get older. And in a sense, these retinues start to get larger and larger and larger. And, again, not to give anything away over here, a retinue, by the time you're looking at someone like Dara Shikoh, which is in the middle of the 17th century, these retinues could amount to 100, 150,000 people. They were extraordinarily large, especially when they were on campaign. A normal-sized retinue could be anywhere between 15 and 30,000 people. Okay, so these are very substantial households, and they're mostly paid for by the prince or by retainers of the prince who are receiving their money from the prince. So the core of this retinue, as it matures in a sense, is this earlier bunch of young boys and companions who had grown up with a prince from the time that he was a small boy. Foster brothers, companions, little male friends. This will, in a sense, be the inner core of all retinues. And proximity to the physical person of the prince determines status. So in other words, the closer you are, the closer you have access to his person, the higher your status. The further out you are, the less access you have, the more unimportant you are. So within these emerging retinues, you begin to see, in a sense, circles of retainers, an inner core, and then, like an onion, layer upon layer upon layer upon layer, with an outer layer that has almost no contact, if ever any contact, with an individual prince. Okay. So, along with retinue construction, the second thing that comes with adult status is the right to marry. And marriage brings its own kinds of networks. The women who these boys are married to, again, are never randomly chosen. And we're never talking about love marriages or anything like that. These are usually always political alliances, and political determinations often shape who these young men will be married to. And as a result, these boys are often married to a cross-section of Indian society. Hindus, Muslims, Northerners, folks from Rajasthan, people from all over the empire. in a sense, through marriages, the empire also does what the emperor had done perhaps in a previous generation, which was to forge ties between itself and India's diverse social, cultural, religious diversity, and political diversity especially. These women will often come with their own retainers. They are often significant in their own right. And so what you will have is a princely retinue that is continuously being irrigated and nourished by various streams of outsiders coming in. And of course, these boys don't just marry one woman. They often end up having multiple marriages, which means that you've got multiple women from different parts of the empire or different contexts, you know, constantly replenishing the retinue at various levels. But the third thing that is very important that comes with adult status is the right to serve as military commanders and as governors of provinces. Prior to adult status, boys are kept at the court, wherever the court might be, whether it's in Delhi or Agra or traveling between Lahore and Kashmir. The boy will always be with his father. But after adult status, the boys get seconded to assignments, and these assignments will often take them to the peripheries of the empire, to places where the emperor himself doesn't want to go, representing imperial authority. And this is a very significant moment. We'll come back to that in a second. Well, actually, let me do it right now. Now, what is going on when these boys are building their retinue, when they're traveling to places like Bengal or the Deccan or Kabul? Effectively, they're doing what you would expect a politician to do. They're glad-handing, they're meeting people, they're hanging out with them, they're trying to cultivate friendships, they're trying to draw people into friendships. In some cases, this is done very subtly. A little gift here, a little gift there, maybe a dinner, maybe a walk in the park together, maybe a ride on an elephant next to your person, nothing major. But in other contexts, you can see princes working extremely hard to recruit individuals into their households. Okay? And this will often be done by giving them big salaries, promising them, you know, rewards and honors if, you know, the prince ever ascends the Mughal throne. But the point is that what the Mughal princes are doing from the time that they are young adults, perhaps for the next 20 to 30 odd years, because that's what the average lifespan, the average span of an imperial reign is. It's about 30 odd years. During this period, life is one big party in a sense. It's like fraternity brothers trying to, you know, meet each other, hang out with each other, make more friends, get to know other people, trying to figure out who will give them a job, you know, someone at Goldman Sachs, that kind of stuff, right? And that's what these princes are basically up to as well. They are trying to figure out, in a sense, the social, political, cultural diversity of India. And most of these boys do a pretty good job. They have a pretty keen sense of where the nodes within Indian society are. This recruitment of people, or this effort to draw people into your ambit, is not just political. I mean, I've been talking mostly about the political, but it also takes other turns. So for example, trying to draw individuals who are part of Sufi networks into a relationship with you, trying to draw particular kinds of literary networks into a relationship with you. The record is filled with examples of princes offering their patronage to poets, to other people, for writing a qasida here, for doing something there. Sometimes for doing nothing much, but just, you know, they give them a reward, they give them an honor. And you often have to wonder, like, what is the purpose behind some of this stuff? Now, some of it might be, as my wife suggests, they just liked those people. It was just about friendship. It was nothing more than that. They had the means to give, and they gave. They gave generously. Yeah, that might be the case in some instances. But for the most part, there is a certain kind of direction behind a lot of the gift giving that happens. And you see this most prominently in the kinds of groups that the princes tend to focus on. Okay. They usually start with groups that are well established within the Mughal Empire. So thinking politically here, and thinking in terms of the major ethnic groups, during Akbar's son's lifetimes, you see them really working hard to attach themselves to Rajputs, to Iranian immigrants, to high-ranking Turkish noblemen, in a sense tying the old elements or the old pillars of imperial rule to themselves. What is interesting, in the course of doing so though, princes begin to also look for people who are unattached to anybody, because there is some value in not having to constantly compete against your brother and, more importantly, against your father. Because remember, the emperor is doing the same thing. He's also giving out gifts. And if your gifts are not the equivalent of the emperor's, you take a lesser status. And so one of the interesting things that one begins to see over the course of the 15 and 1600s is princes don't just try to attach themselves to people who are within the system, but they also increasingly move to people who are outside the system. And so one of the very important consequences of this is you see groups who have been frozen out of the Mughal political system or, you know, other kinds of avenues for patronage being drawn in. In the case of Prince Salim, for example, we begin to see Indian Muslims making their way into first Salim's princely establishment and then ultimately into the Mughal imperial establishment as well. With Prince Aurangzeb in the middle of the 17th century, and he serves as governor in the Deccan for a while, he is the first prince to really make concerted efforts to draw Marathas into his political fold. And so what's interesting in this story, in a sense, is that for those of you who know anything about Mughal history, Aurangzeb will later on fight the Marathas under the leadership of Shivaji. But it's curiously Aurangzeb who makes the first concerted efforts to draw Marathas into the ambit of first his princely retinue and then eventually the Mughal Empire as well. In fact, in the War of Succession, 1657-59, that Aurangzeb fights against his brothers and eventually results in the overthrow of his father, Marathas play a very important role within the fighting force of this supposedly anti-Maratha prince. Indeed, their position is so central to the prince's fighting force and fighting retinue that when they take Delhi, there are riots in Delhi against Aurangzeb's occupation of the city. It's not against Aurangzeb. It's against these uncouth southerners who are not schooled in the ways of Indo-Persian etiquette and other. Delhi doesn't want to have these guys around. It feels like, you know, they've got the barbarians at the gate and they're being let in by none other than Prince Aurangzeb. And so there are these riots in 1659 when, you know, Dara Shikoh is brought back and is about to be executed. It's linked, I think, to this new racial element that has entered into the capital city of the Mughal Empire. The point is, and I don't want to belabor this too much, these princes serve a very important role in drawing groups that are outside of, in a sense, the fold of the empire at that time into relationships with the empire. Now, as I said, at any given time, you have 2 to 5 princes on the imperial stage. Little fewer under Humayun. Humayun only has 2 sons, and one of his boys, Mirza Hakim, is a very young boy when Akbar ascends the throne. But by the time you get into the 1600s, you tend to see boys reaching adulthood, and 3, 4, and in some cases, 5 boys. The centrality of these princes really increases after 1585. And so let me just say something about 1585 as a very important moment in Mughal history and the history of princes, but also the history of Mughal state formation. Prior to 1585, the Mughals maintained an allegiance to an appanage system of princely authority, which means that each prince would get a share of territory that was theirs to have and keep. Okay. This is following on Turkish Central Asian models, which had, you know, been basically in vogue till the time of Akbar. So Babur has a certain number of sons. Each of those boys are given a chunk of territory. This territory functions essentially as a little kingdom. The emperor can meddle a little bit in those little kingdoms, but the emperor, okay, especially if he's a brother, is nothing more than a first among equals, a kind of primus inter pares, nothing more than that. And the destructiveness of this dynamic becomes apparent when Humayun becomes emperor. And when he's fighting the Afghans, he looks to his brothers in their little kingdoms to help him, and they refuse support to Humayun. They refuse to give him men, material, intelligence, other things that he would need to fight off the Afghans under Sher Shah Suri. Now, Humayun may have intended to move away from this model, but he, of course, dies prematurely in 1556, falling down a set of stairs, coming down his observatory in Delhi. And he has two boys. One is Akbar, who's about 13 years old, and another boy, Mirza Hakim, who's only about 1 or 2 years old. Mirza Hakim happens to be in Kabul. Akbar is in India. And so what happens in 1556 is the Mughal Empire, again, is divided into two appanages, so to speak. Akbar's realm and his half-brother's realm in Kabul. Akbar has an extraordinarily testy relationship with his brother. His brother is a nuisance, a gadfly throughout Akbar's, you know, early reign. But Akbar is extraordinarily fortunate because in 1585, Mirza Hakim dies of alcohol poisoning like most of them do. But in the course of doing that, Akbar invades Kabul, doesn't allow Mirza Hakim's sons to ascend the throne of Kabul, and he moves immediately to a new model of princely success or princely visibility. No longer, and this is starting with Akbar's sons, his sons are not given distinct patches of territory. Instead, they will be circulated over the course of their lives as princes all around the empire. And what's really interesting about this switch, in a sense, is that these princes who had once developed really close ties and embedded ties in a region will now be forced to do the kinds of things that I've already talked about, which is circulating, meeting, getting to know the empire. And the reason this is important is because ultimately the Mughals after 1585 are moving towards, in a sense, you know, system is perhaps the wrong word, but they're moving towards an order in which one boy is going to take over the throne of Delhi, in a sense contravening Islamic law that allows for every boy to have an equal share of the patrimony of his father. So there is this one very important shift, but the Mughals never talk about it. It's never addressed in sources, it's never remarked upon, but it is very clear that this is a very distinct and very important shift that happens. Now, coming back to network construction, as I suggested, princes have about 30 years in which to do their thing. This is lots and lots and lots of time for them to essentially gear up for an impending war of succession. But the rise of princes and retinues also, in as much as it offers a point of support for the dynasty and for the power of the emperor perhaps, also is a source of great anxiety for the emperor. Because as these retinues with accompanying networks become larger and stronger and more extensive across the face of the Mughal Empire, the possibility, the potential for these boys to challenge their father also increases. Now, in a period when the life expectancy of people was in the 30s, when elites may have lived on average into their 40s, maybe early 50s, a boy who's in his 30s is beginning to feel his mortality in a sense, and is perhaps a little less willing to be pushed around and bossed by his father than, you know, someone who's 12 or 13. Curiously, we don't know where problems usually start. Is it because these retinues become too powerful, threatening the power of the emperor, or whether it's because of boys who get impatient and want power for themselves? But the point just is that there is a certain kind of dynamic that gets set up, especially when these boys get into their 20s and early 30s, where they begin to challenge the emperor's right to interfere not just in their retinues, but also they begin to do things in their own bailiwicks, whether they're governors of Bengal or the Deccan or somewhere else, which is clearly designed to help themselves at the expense sometimes of the emperor. So, for example, the emperor sometimes wants to punish someone because they have been corrupt or they have, you know, done something horrible. And what does the person do? They go to the prince and beg the prince to basically intercede for them with their father. The emperor will often say, no, you, you've got to punish this person to set an example of them. And in certain instances, princes will protect this person within their own retinue and dare their father to come after this person. It happens all the time. The point just is, folks, that these retinues do constitute a real challenge to the power of the emperor. Inasmuch, and this is the paradox, inasmuch as they are extraordinarily helpful for imperial rule and focusing attention on the Mughals and the Mughal dynasty, they also have this kind of side effect. Invariably, emperors do not, these kinds of challenges do not go unnoticed. And emperors will often do everything in their power to begin to clip the wings off boys, put them in their place, so to speak. Now, princes don't rebel because they are bellicose and, you know, warlike. They rebel because they feel that their future is being imperiled. They rebel when they feel that their father is transferring people out of their retinue who they think is going to be very important for a future war of succession. When emperors try to do this, and that's what I meant by clipping wings, invariably princes will first beg their father not to do so, then they will demand that their father behave differently, and finally, once all other avenues have been closed to a kind of right of appeal, princes will go into rebellion. Interestingly, before 1585, we don't tend to see princes going into rebellion against their fathers because the stakes are lower and the system is different. After 1585, with the move to the, you know, the model of the entire empire as a stage for your actions, we begin to see regular princely rebellions against a father. And invariably, it's always the favorite son who rebels against his father. Again, it seems counterintuitive, but he usually is the one who's been given all the favors by daddy and then becomes too strong and father starts to pull back. So you see this with Salim, who's the favorite son of Akbar. You see it with Khurram, who's the favorite son of Shah Jahan. You see it with Muazzam or Bahadur Shah, who is the favorite son of Aurangzeb. Each of these boys will ultimately go into rebellion against their father. What I'm trying to basically say here, ladies and gentlemen, is that rebellion is a cry for help. It's not what historians have usually said, which is that, you know, these crazy princes who, you know, want to destroy the system are at work here. No, it usually happens as a last resort. Rebellion is a moment that really tests the resolve of a prince. Retinues sometimes crack under the pressure of rebellions, in the face especially of superior and stronger imperial foes, the emperor in particular. There's always a threat of death in a rebellion. And so rebellion comes with consequences and potential drawbacks for any prince. So they go there gingerly and always as a last resort, never as a first resort. But that said, rebellion nonetheless offers opportunities both for the dynasty and also for individual princes. For the dynasty, again, you'll have princes circulating through the empire, often fleeing, but fighting and fleeing, trying to draw supporters to themselves against their father's forces or against the forces of their brother. Groups, again, who have been peripheral to the life of the empire usually find a way into the Mughal Empire during moments of rebellion, and we see this repeatedly. Perhaps the best example of this is during Prince Khurram's rebellion, who in the end becomes Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan has a four-year-long rebellion against his father. Actually, it's even longer than that. It's 1622 to 1627, the death of his father. During this period, Prince Khurram, or Shah Jahan, travels 12,000 miles. He travels from Agra down into central India, across the northern Deccan to Bengal. He makes his way up to Bihar. Then he moves back to Bengal, through the Deccan again, through Gujarat. He's thinking of going via Sindh. Then he backtracks back into the Deccan. So, I mean, these guys are traveling all over the place, and they're doing exactly what they have been trained to do. So rebellions mark this moment in time when groups begin to attach themselves to particular princes, and in so doing, they are also being drawn, in a sense, into a kind of larger Mughal world, and this is very, very, very important in my mind. Anyway, that said, the mobilization of the prince doesn't go unmatched. The emperor is doing the same thing. And so if you think of empires not just as bureaucratic structures, or you think of states not just as bureaucratic structures, but as networks of power, networks that are constituted through political networks, intellectual networks, social networks, economic networks, this is how it happens. It happens through meetings, it happens through contact, it happens in spaces where bureaucracies don't function, where the Mughals have no administrative capacity. How else do the Mughals make their way in places that, you know, have been recently conquered? Well, it's often through this mechanism of rebellion and then crushing the rebellion as well. Okay, last part of my talk. Ultimately, this is all headed towards the big moment, the big moment in these boys' lives. And just in case you were wondering, these boys do not think of each other as brothers. I mean, they're brothers, yes, half-brothers, what have you. But they don't have any affection for each other, none. Indeed, they see each other at best as enemies, at worst as murderers. After all, their life depends on killing one another. So the important thing to understand, in a sense, from the time that these boys are cognizant, that they have a certain basic understanding of their place in the world, they are in a kind of competitive mode. What does this do for a person? I mean, I have a son who's now 10 years old, and I've often wondered, because much of this book was written while he was a very young boy, and I would have to say it makes you completely, utterly crazy. You would have to, right? You don't trust anybody. You do not think of your family, which should be, in a sense, the unit of support, as your enemy, in fact, your greatest enemy. So these boys are totally and utterly ruthless. And one of the things that happens over the course of their early decades is these boys become extraordinarily hardened emotionally, psychologically. They're very thick-skinned in many contexts. And they're prepared to do anything. The result, of course, is that they're willing to kill their brothers. They're willing to dethrone their fathers if need be. And when we hear these stories, we're like, oh my goodness, these horrible Mughals. Aurangzeb overthrew his father. How could he do that? We are taking a kind of modern lens and not really thinking about the context in which these boys grew up, which is one of, you know, hyper-competition and a kind of crazy psychology that would come with it. Ultimately, wars of succession are decided by the prince with the strongest retinue and also the prince with the best networks. And we see this happening again and again and again. You never see a weak prince ascending the Mughal throne, not between the reign of Akbar and the time of Aurangzeb. They are all, at least on paper, the best, most battle-hardened princes. Curiously, and this is the footnote to this, Dara Shikoh is the prince that people always remember, because he's the prince who never became the king. But in a sense, Dara Shikoh's life and his failure is not presaged by his Hindu-Muslim correspondence work. It's not because of the Upanishads and his decision or his intellectual interests beyond a kind of legalistic mainstream Islamic ambit. It has to do, I think, arguably, with the fact that Dara Shikoh is one of these odd Mughal princes, and he really is in some ways singular, who never gets sent away from the Mughal court to run a province, to lead a military campaign, with the exception of one campaign that Sunil and I were talking about last night, when he is sent against Kandahar to fight the Safavids, and he loses, I mean, in glorious fashion. And it's one of the few times when there is actually, there are these secret accounts written about just how bad he was. Okay. In a sense, people expect their emperor to do a better job than that. This is still an expansionist state. It still has a sense of itself as, you know, conquering frontiers within the South Asian context that, you know, have never fallen under Muslim rule, perhaps, and certainly not under Mughal rule. So you want to have an emperor who can promise you further rewards, honors, land, and so on and so forth. Dara Shikoh does not promise that, and in a sense, it was his undoing. So the final kind of questions that I want to leave you pondering is that what happens to these princes once they come to the throne? Curiously, not surprisingly, they execute their brothers. I mean, that's to be expected. But what happens to the followers of their brothers? What happens to the household of the brother? What happens to women in the household of the brother? Contra to the example of the Safavids and the Ottomans, the Mughals actually forgive the vast majority of a prince's supporters. These supporters invariably will be reaccommodated and reincorporated into the empire, maybe not at the highest levels as they might have been had their prince won, but they're not executed for the most part. And in the few instances when individuals are executed, it's because of lese majeste, because that person may have done certain things that were considered beyond the pale, engaging in a certain kind of behavior that went beyond certain norms of acceptable conduct given a kind of princely conflict. So what we have, in a sense, is a system that both reconstitutes itself at the end of a war of succession by not brutally murdering and killing everybody, but also a system where a prince's household or retinue invariably makes its way into the highest echelons of imperial power. The consequence of this, folks, is that the Mughal nobility begins to represent the diversity of India from generation to generation to generation. And there is a kind of meritocracy that gets built into the political structures of the Mughal Empire by virtue of the fact, by evidence of the fact that you rarely see more than two generations of a noble family staying at the top rungs of power. Usually, they will end up falling out of power, choosing the wrong side, making mistakes, and being replaced by someone else. And so there isn't an entrenched nobility within the Mughal Empire where you've got family lineages that continue for five, six, seven generations. That does not happen. You very rarely see that. Now, if the system is so great, why don't we have Mughals today? Why didn't the Mughals survive the 18th century? Okay? I've made arguments as to why they, you know, so successfully, in a sense, encompass India's diversity. Well, then, you know, why are they not around? I would argue that, to some degree, the collapse of the Mughal Empire in the late 1600s and definitely in the early 1700s has a lot to do with circumstances that have nothing to do with the princes. For example, stresses of warfare in the Deccan, a lack of financial resources, the need as their finances start to suffer because of endless warfare in the south and an inability to get money, the need for help from Aurangzeb to build up their retinues begins to impact the prince's capacity to stand alone and separate from their father. Aurangzeb begins to meddle in these retinues, not because he's looking for a sneaky way to undermine his sons. It's because his sons go to him and say, "Dad, I was supposed to receive 30 million rupees this year, and, you know, the city Marathas have just, you know, attacked my convoy. I have no silver, I have no gold. I can't pay the salaries of my men." So what does Aurangzeb do? He gives them loans to keep their retinues afloat, but he also seconds people from the imperial administration into princely retinues, which of course princes love, because they don't have to pay these guys. These guys are being paid on by the father. But of course, this means that the father has greater control over these princely retinues. The consequence of this, folks, is that Aurangzeb has more power over his sons' retinues, households, and their capacity to, in a sense, build their own patronage networks than any of the previous princely generations had. Aurangzeb's aging, okay, and now this is a completely random thing to throw out here, but, you know, he lives to 91 years of age. This is a system that demands 3, 4, 5 princes at a given time. By the time Aurangzeb dies in 1707, he is 91. He's outlived everybody. He, in fact, has got sons who are in their 60s. He's got grandsons who are in their 40s. He's got great-grandsons who are in their 20s, and he's got great-great-grandsons who are being born. By the time he dies in 1707, there are something like 21 adult princes. A system cannot handle this. You cannot have 21. Power has to find some way to focus on a much smaller number. The problem is that Aurangzeb does not do what he should have done, which is to kill all his extra sons or grandsons or great-grandsons. I mean, that would have been much too ruthless, right? So he lets them live, but the problem is that with 21 sons, each son's capacity to do what princes were doing in previous generations is compromised. And eventually, each of these sons will turn to very powerful Mughal noblemen who are often raised by Aurangzeb himself to basically win the Mughal throne. The last thing I want to say on the question of noblemen, Aurangzeb, as he ages and as he begins to experience military defeat in the Deccan, not trusting his sons, looks to a group of young noblemen, people who are trained by him within his own household. People like Nizam ul-Mulk, who would be the founder of Hyderabad, and a whole number of other very consequential Mughal insiders. He will train them, and he will often use them as counterweights against his sons. In his last decade of warfare in the Deccan, he sends all his sons out of the Deccan because he doesn't want them challenging his authority, and the biggest Mughal armies, the most lucrative expeditions in the Deep South, are not run by boys from his own line, but by nobles who are accruing money, who are accruing power. And guess what? In 1707, when the time comes for a war of succession, these princes, for the first time in 150 odd years, are forced to go and basically supplicate or beg these nobles to support them. And for the first time in 150 odd years, nobles will sometimes say no. They will sit out a war of succession, which they had never done before. The system essentially, folks, is completely compromised, and it gets ever more degraded when you consider the fact that we don't have wars of succession every 30 years where the dust is allowed to settle, you're allowed to go through the processes of princely retinue construction, all the other stuff. After Aurangzeb dies in 1707, there's a war of succession. Then there's another one in 1712. Then there's one in 1713. Then there's one in 1719. And guess what? In 1719, the Mughal system basically collapses when the most powerful Mughal nobleman succeeds in putting a puppet emperor on the throne, a complete turnaround of what had once been the case. With the collapse of the Mughal princely institution, I argue, you will see the collapse of the Mughal empire as well. Four points, and I'll finish very quickly. My book, the work that I have done for this book, has a number of different tangents. I think the things that I find most significant about the work in some ways is the fact that I think bureaucracies matter. I think state structures are important. But I think states build themselves up through a whole series of other mechanisms. And in a sense, it's my interest in networks that dominates this study. And so again, historians of the illegal school often attack me like, well, you don't take enough consideration of administrative structures. Well, I do. You've done the work. I'm adding to it. The second thing that I think my work kind of gestures to is the fact that power is not forged at the center of the Mughal Empire. Power is actually forged in the peripheries. Princes who stay in the center are princes who will lose. So in a sense, Mughal chronicles play a trick on us. With all their focus on images of emperors and the visuals of emperors and the power of the imperial court, whether it's in Agra or Delhi, actually obscures the fact that power is not forged in Delhi and Agra. It's forged in Bengal, it's forged in the Deccan, it's forged in Kabul and other places that would be considered peripheral to the imagination of, say, a Mughal chronicler and certainly to historians of the contemporary Mughal Empire. The third point is that the Mughal Empire is often seen as static. Akbar builds it, and then it just kind of exists. And what my work tries to point you to is a continuously evolving state structure, both in terms of succession systems, but also in terms of the personnel who are moving in and out of this empire. It's never static. It keeps evolving. It keeps moving for the period that I am looking at, 1504 to 1720. And finally, and this, I promise, the last thing I'm going to say, the question of decline. You know, it's an issue that, you know, again, lots and lots of folks have looked at. And people often attribute, you know, Mughal collapse to Aurangzeb's bigotry, to the fact that, the Mughals fought these unnecessary wars in the Deccan, so on and so forth. I think, you know, I certainly have a problem with the whole bigotry explanation. But I think there is so much else that is happening in the late 1600s. And unfortunately, historians tiptoe around the figure of Aurangzeb and tiptoe around him because he is, as Professor Asani correctly said, so controversial, and no one wants to be seen as an apologist for what Aurangzeb is, which is, you know, a horrible, bad Muslim, you know, who we can all agree to dislike. And so in a sense, what I'm arguing effectively with this book also is a reconsideration, or the beginning of a reconsideration, of politics in the Aurangzeb period, and an attempt to move away from this kind of Hindu-Muslim binary of, you know, good Muslim, good Hindu, bad Hindu, and so on and so forth. On that note, I will end. Thank you for your patience.
So thank you very much for that really wonderful lecture, giving us an overview of what's going on in the Mughal court. I'm going to open it. We have time for a couple of questions. But I did want, as you were talking about all the sons, just my familiarity with some of Mughal history also shows us that there were some very important daughters who played an important role. And I wonder whether you can talk us, how does the dynamics play out, you know, between sons and daughters?
Right. Thank you so much. That's a great question. Inasmuch as sons are given very large sums of money after they become adults, the same is true for these daughters, the most powerful daughters in the empire. Women like Jahanara, Roshanara, Gohrara, you know, who are all daughters of Shah Jahan. These women, at various points in time, will have access to, again, tens of millions of rupees in a given year. Many of these women are not the creatures of the imperial harem that, you know, Orientalist historians would like have us believe, which is just, you know, sitting over there lolling around, you know, pining for the day when they either get married or they get, you know, taken out of the harem. These are women with very distinct political personas, and they often will deploy them, again, in favor of one brother or another. And so one of the most interesting examples happens in 1657-59, when Shah Jahan's major, most important daughters will support different brothers. And so, for example, Jahanara, who's the most important daughter at the time, the oldest daughter supports her oldest brother, Dara Shikoh. Roshanara supports Aurangzeb, and Gohrara supports Murad. And so these women also have political personas of their own, but because of the way in which power works in the empire and focuses energy on the princes, women will have to work through brothers or through nephews or through, you know, whoever the main contenders are. So these women are extraordinarily important. And indeed, the final thing I would just say about this is that in the case of Dara Shikoh's war of succession against Aurangzeb and his other brothers, he basically runs out of cash pretty quickly after the Battle of Samugarh when he's defeated. And anyone who has money is like, I'm not going to give you any more money. You're a complete loser and you're going to be defeated. And his sister, Jahanara, begins to open up her coffers to basically subsidize his continued war of succession. And he will continue to fight on for another year and a half, mostly drawing on resources that his sister is providing to him. So these women are extraordinarily important. And they're important as sisters, but they're also important as mothers early on in their lives, but also as foster mothers and as wives. And my, you know, book, you know, attempts to gesture to some of the more important figures within the empire. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, Professor. Thanks very much for an interesting talk today. My name is Jesse. I'm an associate at the Weatherhead Center for International Affairs. And I work on the Portuguese Empire in Asia. So your talk was really very interesting, especially your discussion of sort of these power networks and how Mughal princes and emperors moved along, sort of searching for patrons and to draw things into these networks. I work in history of religions, and I know a lot about Akbar's great religious debates at his court. Mm. And this is often then talked about in the history of religions as, well, Akbar was so philosophically advanced and he loved, you know, sort of the intellectual challenge of meeting and talking to all these people. But your talk today made me think, well, maybe actually this was better viewed in the idea of these network politics, where Akbar was attempting to get information about different parts of the world. Where could he expand to? Where could he find allies? Where could he find support for himself as the universal emperor. I mean, how does this reflect on your, I mean, what do you think from your perspective?
Well, you know, I don't think it's mutually exclusive. I mean, I think Akbar is intellectually extraordinarily curious. I think he's a singularly interesting person, and we would, in a sense, you know, engage in real, a certain kind of violence to, you know, this capacious intellectual who is interested, I mean, and genuinely interested in Jainism, in Hinduism, in Zoroastrianism, in perhaps Jesuits and other groups. You know, it's you can argue that much of what Akbar is doing is trying to bring both these phenomena together, namely his own interest in certain kinds of religious debates, trying to understand to some extent India's diversity, perhaps trying to engage in a certain amount of religious edification for himself, but also simultaneously in doing so, figuring out, you know, India, figuring out what, you know, in a sense, putting his hand on the pulse of the empire through a certain group of people who he's invited into the Ibadat Khana. So he will meet other people in other contexts. In the Mughal court, for example, he will meet political leaders. In other contexts in campaign, he will meet other people. But maybe this was one way by which he felt that he could also begin to understand this empire that he happens to be ruling over. And, you know, to, in a sense, understand why Akbar would be interested in doing so. I mean, the Mughal Empire is refounded effectively in Akbar's reign in starting in 1556. Yeah. And the Mughals don't have a very long kind of intellectual history and engagement with India. Akbar is kind of cobbling it together and figuring out what is happening around him. So I would be very careful to go with a single explanation of what Akbar is up to, but a more capacious one perhaps, which is to say that, you know, he's engaged in multiple things at the same time. And there may have been a political element as well, although it's not necessary that there was a political element to those religious debates, because he would have met Portuguese ambassadors, often, you know, Christian missionaries or Jesuits. He would have met all the people that he meets in the Ibadat Khana in other contexts as well during his campaigns. There's no reason to assume that he would, that the only space he could meet them was in the Ibadat Khana. What the Ibadat Khana perhaps affords him is a kind of private space. But, you know, but nonetheless, it would add to his understanding of the empire while at the same time helping him, you know, figure out whether he's a good Muslim or not. Thank you.
We have a question.
Can we pass the mic for the floor?
Oh, it's okay. I'm Afsha. As you may know, I work on Mohammed Begum. And your book was really important to me during my writing my dissertation, and I'm writing my book too. And it was interesting to sort of survey these networks of princes, but I thought the first question that Professor Asani asked you about women is really, it's more than just important, it's almost emphatically integral to these networks, because there's this culture, this imperial propaganda that is sustained by the females of each successive emperor. And the way that they control policy through the emperor, and even control the princes through these women. So, and I guess I understand, you know, other people are doing that like me, and I'm pressuring this lens that you're using to see how how she's using that to convey the same type of powers.
Yeah.
And I have to disagree with a couple of things that you said, because you mentioned that she had given him money during the War of Secession, but in fact, I'm not sure where, maybe we can talk about that later, but she actually wrote letters to him to say that he had to follow his Islamic duty and to give up, and even visited him in tent, and talks about how that he has to do right by his father, and the oldest son, as opposed to, I think maybe I misunderstood or misheard, instead of inheritance, I mean, it's Islam, the Islamic law is yes, the boys do get equal share once the father dies, but succession is the oldest son. And she writes at length about in the letter that that he has a right, and you have to do right by him to let Dara Shikro, you know, assume the throne. And
so she's writing. I'm sorry. She's writing to Aurangzeb.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And then she visits him in the camp to try to appeal to him. And so this type of ambassador or you know kind of role that she has is not highly representative when you look at women, but
it actually is. These women are absolutely central at all
yeah.
the moments of turmoil and conflict within
right.
the royal family. Women always play a central role,
yeah.
in a sense, refereeing between men.
Yes.
And so between
yes.
Akbar and Salim, you've
right.
got you know Akbar's mom and other women,
right.
high-ranking women, trying to referee between them.
Yeah.
So this is not unusual. It's not just in the moment of 1657.
Right.
Women are throughout.
Yeah, I mean the whole petticoat government is not you know, it's not diluted at all.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it's almost there's a lot more infrastructure
yeah.
based on what started with Akbar and Babur even, and I found that the women. Just, you know, because we don't have a lot of many sources about what, you know, they didn't record what they did, except for Jahana, who did record. And the war you were talking about in Kandahar, for example, she overly romanticizes it. She doesn't call Dara Shikoh as losing it, and really uses the frame of the mirrors of princes to say that he has these qualities where he... in many ways was very sensitive to his troops who would have died if they kept on going, so he brought them back. So she didn't let him be a loser, but, you know, just to say that he's just a sensitive, you know, that warrior is that is the perfection of emperor. So it's just interesting to hear you talk about it, because I'm looking at it from a very different mode, and Aurangzeb, and you also said something about the favored son is the one that rebels against the emperor, but in fact, it's not the favored son that rebels. I mean, Aurangzeb is not the favored son, and he
but
talks about...
But Aurangzeb is not in a rebellion. Aurangzeb only enters into a conflict with his father once it seems that a war of succession is upon them. So he doesn't go in the 1650s into rebellion against Shah Jahan.
Right, but it
right.
does start before that. I mean, they've had these lots of infighting between
but
father and son.
But it's not rebellion, Afshan. That's not, he doesn't,
no,
he doesn't draw
I mean,
up his
sorry.
Canon
yeah.
and stuff like
no,
that.
No, it's not a rebellion, but there's conflict. And
there
and,
is
and
conflict
he,
and disobedience
yeah.
coursing
right.
throughout the entire system.
Yeah.
In a sense, what you have is a spectrum of behavior
right.
from overt disobedience to antics off the stage disobedience
yeah.
to actual rebellion. I mean, there's a whole range of behavior between... you know, obedience and rebellion.
Right.
And in a sense, you know, I think that has to also be said. What Aurangzeb was engaged in was many forms of disobedience without actually going into rebellion against his father.
Right, right. No, I'm sorry, I misstated.
You know,
but
sorry,
one thing that I was just talking, I was thinking about was that you didn't mention, but your book does have some details of it, is how each emperor since Akbar is upholding the imperial propaganda, how each prince has to uphold that to basically position himself. So, for example, writing the autobiography or you know commissioning paintings or architecture or whatever
right.
Endowments. I mean, that's part of the staging. I
yes,
don't.
It is.
I mean, I don't think it's just making friends and giving
no,
them
no,
money,
no, no.
but. But, you know, giving money to poets
yes.
is not random, and it's not because they're kind. It's because they are following that tradition.
Sure.
And for them, the women of the family are telling them, like, you know, you should do this now because this
yeah.
is important and the people will have more confidence. So it would be great to have, like, a mashup of my book and your book to just...
Well, you can do it.
No way.
I'm done with my dear friends,
yeah,
the princes.
The
no, I would just say, I don't think we're in disagreement, Afshan. I mean, I think the theatrics of power, beyond, I mean, for the purpose of today's talk, I kept it largely focused on the kinds of networks that they construct. But the theater of power is also absolutely central. And
absolutely.
You see it in the naming of towns
yes.
after themselves. And this happens across the 17th century. Particular kinds of rituals and other kinds of things. I mean, it's always about them and
right.
ultimately about, you know, a kind of magnification of their own individual importance.
Sure.
But ultimately, I mean, where does this all end up? It ends up kind of feeding into this trough of Mughal imperial legitimacy and power.
Until
Aurangzeb,
who basically drops the ball on the imperial propaganda, doesn't want a biography.
So.
His munshi is like, come on, tell
yeah.
me some things so I can write something.
So, Afshan, can I interrupt?
I'm sorry.
Because, you know, we have to leave here at 5:30
yeah,
and
I
want to get other
so
people
sorry.
To have their questions there. So,
yeah.
you know, you're welcome to talk to him afterwards,
sure.
but we have a question there.
Yes, and there is a commonality in the meritocracy in the Mughal and Safavid and Ottoman Empire. Would you comment on the origin of this habit or policy?
On the meritocracy?
Yes, this is a system of meritocracy that helped the sultans and helped the Safavids and everybody else. Where does it come from?
I mean, it comes from the fact that these are, in a sense...
Is it religious? Is it tribal? Is it...
It can be those things. It could be religious. It could be tribal. It could be a whole number of other elements. You see, in pre-modern states where you don't have very powerful bureaucratic structures, you need to find other ways in which to fill the vacuum of political power. And what all states will do, and this is not just true for the Ottomans or the Safavids, but you know, also in East Asia, you will see states effectively trying to draw in groups that are, you know, potential challengers or groups that can buttress the power of the ruling dynasty. So, for example, in the case of the Safavids, I mean, it's groups like the Qizilbash who have been, you know, peripheral to the power of, the settled late 1400 states. And so where does Shah Ismail go? He goes to these peripheral frontier tribes, he mobilizes them, and he brings them into the system. Later on, Shah Abbas brings in Georgians and other kinds of Turkish groups from Khorasan and places like that. They're getting drawn into a system as a way of, in a sense, buttressing the system.
So
and the Ottomans are doing the same thing. They
so
bring in Albanians, they
right.
bring in Balkans, and all sorts of groups.
So you are saying it's more tribal than religious?
Well, it's just the way state structure... I mean, a successful state has to be, in a sense, inclusive. When a state starts to become increasingly exclusive, it opens itself up to the possibility of challenge. Now, of course, for the problem the Mughals experience is that an earlier inclusivity is replaced ultimately in the late 1600s with a certain degree of exclusivity. And this is because the groups that had made their way into the Mughal system in the 15 and early 1600s become deeply ensconced in the system, they become entrenched in the system, and they don't want to start to have to give up some of their power and privileges to new groups. So what you see, especially in the Mughal case, are groups like the Jats, the Sikhs, the Marathas, who are the biggest opponents of the accommodation of these groups into the empire. It turns out to be Rajputs, not necessarily Aurangzeb. It's the Rajputs who say, you can't let the Jats in, you can't let the Sikhs in. They are, in fact, you know, they're not of high class enough standard. They're not worthy of the Mughal empire. I mean, they use that kind of a rhetoric, but what they're actually saying is, we don't want to share the perquisites of power with them. And so what you begin to see in the case of the late 1600s, certainly, is a certain kind of exclusivity, which then also meets, especially when the Mughals are in the deep south, in the Deccan, a certain kind of northern Indo-Persian cultural world that is just at odds with what you have existing in the south. And the Mughals don't have the capacity to accommodate that difference. So, you know, I don't know if I answered your question, but the point is that it's not just tribal. It could be anything.
It's funny because the Ottomans gave up the system at the same time.
Yeah.
Mid-1600.
Ottomans and Safavids do.
Yeah.
That's true.
Okay. So we have a
comment and a question. The comment is that the Ottomans, they had a better system. They killed all the brothers.
That's right.
And the question is, what was the role of opiates and the demise of the Mughal Empire.
Okay, in terms of just your comment, Shah Jahan is the first emperor to actually go about killing his nephews and other young men in the royal family. So there is this kind of expunging of male competitors, especially of collateral lines, starting in Shah Jahan's reign. But it causes such horror within among Mughals that Aurangzeb, when given a similar chance to take care of Dara Shikoh's oldest son, fights against him, so he has to be punished. But his second son ends up marrying Aurangzeb's daughter. Murad's sons end up marrying Aurangzeb's daughters as well. And you have a lot of first cousin, cross cousin marriages in the late 1600s because of a certain revulsion to this killing thing that had happened in the 1620s. And at another point in time, Akbar, when he's told the news that the Ottoman emperor, I think it was Mehmed the second or third, that in 1595 he had killed, you know, something like 18 or 20 male competitors, Akbar is, oh my goodness, how does this guy expect to rule an empire if he's going to behave in such a horrible, miserable way? So the Mughals tended not to do this. They tended to kill people who had fought against the emperor in battle at the princely level. Everyone else goes free, and that includes sons and, of course, daughters of a defeated prince. On the question of opiates, it has no role in the destruction of the Mughal Empire. Aurangzeb is a teetotaler. He's the only teetotaling prince, as far as I know, who neither consumes opium nor drinks alcohol. And you would think that given such high morals, the empire would have gone from strength to strength into the 18th century, and it doesn't. But maybe it has something to do with his sons and grandsons, who are all heavy drinkers and all opium consumers as well. Absolutely, all of them were. It was part of a kind of social ambiance. It was a way in which, I mean, again, not to belabor the point, but like fraternities and sororities tend to overserve alcohol as a way of lubricating social relations. Alcohol consumption and opium consumption was a very important way for very uptight, high-strung individuals to let their hair down and become normal. Be relaxed. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. All right. I think with that we have to stop, unfortunately, because we're at the 5:30.
I just have a question.
Okay, very short.
Did Aurangzeb blind Shah Jahan?
No, he doesn't blind
his father. No, that is the story. Mm-hmm. That he was blind.
He never blinds his father. His father dies under house arrest in 1666. So no, he doesn't blind him. But he does take care of two of his brothers. Dara Shikoh and Murad are both executed by Aurangzeb.
The story circulating is that he put Shah Jahan in this house, which looked at the Taj Mahal. And
never believe everything you hear at the various monuments in Delhi and Agra. That's the moral of the story.
All right.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you
very much.